Let's model charge pump PLL by using Python programming language. We'll briefly go over basic operation of a charge pump PLL, and then each building block of a charge pump model, charge pump PLL will be modeled by using Python programming language. And then finally, we'll perform phase demodulation operation by using this model. Okay, so let's compare some languages used for hardware modeling, I mean behavior model of some circuit. C language, Python and MATLAB. C is the fastest. It's pretty fast. So we can model at the low level also. And then for the readability, this Python is the best. MATLAB is fine, but Python has a code length is even shorter. Availability, C and Python, they are public domain. They are free. Libraries. Python is a massive library. MATLAB is also a large library. But Python is a much larger library here. So we want to model. The best policy may be the engine part. The engine, hardware engine may be modeled by C. And hardware engine modeled by C, and graph routine can be modeled by Python or MATLAB. Okay, then because this C language is very fast, then by using this C language, we can print out files output into a hard disk driver or solid state disk. And then this Python program can read that file and then display some graph on the screen. All right, Python library, NumPy, some numerical calculation, like array operation, and then some math functions like sine function, exponential, log, or those functions are included in NumPy package. Package is a library. And TensorFlow, this is very, very popular for deep learning. SciPy, scientific calculation, similar to NumPy. And LibLosa, audio processing. And then this OS is some operating system, file management, something like that. There are a lot of libraries for Python, okay? So Python is slow, like MATLAB. They are interpreter. This is interpreter. C language, they use compiler. Interpreter is slow. But interpreter has, we can run program interactively, also in batch mode, okay? For batch mode, we look like that. Say, in the command line on the terminal, say, we just type this one, and then it can run batch mode. Okay, let's try some Python interactively. Okay, I'm running this one in the Windows, okay? Then, let me type window key here, and then I type CMD here. Then, my command screen pops up. So, I will go to my folder. I use a tab for completion. Oh, not completed here. Okay, I will put some alias here. My alias is a directory, so I will go to LEC. I didn't go class. Okay. Class. All right. Tap. Okay. So I will go to Python. Python folder here. Yeah. And then let's type Python interactively. So we'll use NumPy extensively in this class. So we import NumPy as MP here, maybe just N. All right. Then see, I can put something like time, say. I want to put time mp dot lin space 0 to 1 second. They are included, both 0 and 1 and included. Start from 0, ends at 1 second. Say I want to put just like that. Okay. Oops. How come? Oh, yeah, I just put mp, not mp, n, right? So in, all right, good. So see, this T is pretty. It starts from 0, ends at 1. It has 10,001 elements here, right? Oh yeah, it's an array. All right. So I wanna put a cosine function here. See, my S is np numpy dot sine function. 2 times numpy dot pi times t. So this is my sine function. Also, I also import my plot package. Matplotlib pyplot as a p. Okay, oops. Matplotlib, not mess. Matplotlib. Like matlab, right? Matplotlib. Plotlib, okay? As a P. Okay. All right, let me plot my P dot plot my S, And then P dot show. Oh yeah, I have my sine function here, right? See, I will put my cosine function also. All right. So I just I put my cosine. Cosine is my numpy cosine twice numpy pi times t. Okay, this is my cosine function. I want to plot both. Yeah, both, no. Yeah, this is, instead of a p-show, I just plot cosine there, and then P dot show, okay? Then I will see both sine and cosine on a graph. Alright? Yeah, this blue one is a sine. This red one is a cosine. See, this is just index. I want to plot T here for the x-axis. My T range is from 0 to 1, right? So in that case, see, I just put T there. Okay? T comma sine, T comma cosine. Okay, let me put it that way. Oh yeah, so it's just something like that. Yeah, I want to put some title there. How can I put my title? My title is here. See, P dot title, my cosine, sine and cosine. Okay. Yeah. Also, I want to put x label. It's a time second, right? P dot x label. Time second. Yeah, like that. All right. Okay. Oh yeah, I have x label. I have a title there. Okay. So convenient. It's good. calculator, right? I can draw, say something like n dot c exponential, something like that. Oh yeah, so it works fine, right? Okay, so this time let's do more complete one. So let's see, let's try this thing. This one is the same thing with some lissage pattern. Oh yeah, this is the same thing here. See, this is my instead of n, I just put np for this numpy. Np is the alias for numpy packaging. Matplotlib pyplot is plt. Okay, so my t is here. It includes 0 and 1. It has 10,001 elements. This omega t is t times 2 pi. Okay, so this omega t is also has 10,001 elements. This is a vector, one-dimensional vector. So my s is a sine function. This is another array with the same element. C is my cosine. S2 is something else. Oh yeah, this is just 45 degrees ahead of sine. Right? My cosine is actually same as my sine omega t plus 90 degrees, right? Ahead. My base is larger than this one by 90 degrees. Cosine leads sine by 90 degrees. Okay, so I just plot sine, cosine, as in this example. Oh, it has some label. And then, second one is let's see. Oh, this title. So I put 3-1, 3-1, say PLT show is here. So I put all those things, all three graphs in figure one, because this one is, they are on the same, on a single graph. And then for the figure two, and we have some lissage pattern, PLT show. This region, the thing is some label for each graph, right? So each graph, we have a label X, sine, so this is a label for this graph. And there is another one, label, for this label. And then that thing is displayed by this legend command, okay? And then we have this PLT show that shows another one. Okay, so let's try this one in a batch mode, okay? So here, see, I have my file. I'm in DOS command line, which is lissage, okay? lissage.py. Yeah, this is the one I have shown in the PowerPoint, okay? I will try this one in run batch mode, lissage.py. Oh yeah, first one, see? I have three graph, right? Title and legend. Legend shown in the label. Yeah, blue one is a sine. Red one cosine. And then this green one is in the middle. Just 45 degrees ahead of sine, right? It leads the sine function by 45 degrees cosine, 90 degrees. Okay. And then this is a lissage pattern. Let's see. It looks like a lissage. Right? Say first one, blue one is a circle, right? X is a sine function, Y is a cosine function. It is a circle of radius 1. If Y is just leading 45 degrees by sine, and it's an ellipse, okay? It's fine. Okay. Let's go back to the main job. Oh, yeah. We can solve algebraic equation easily by using Python. Okay, so I have my algebraic equation here. 2x plus 3y equal minus 4. And then 3x minus y equal 5. So what is x and y? So this is my simultaneous equation, right? So for that one, see, we convert this one into a matrix equation. Then, see, my xy will be inverse matrix of this one. Times this vector. Okay. So, yeah, this A matrix is 2 by 3 for the first row, 3 minus 1 on the second row. Okay, this one. This is my A. Okay. And then inverse is this one. A inverse is numpy linear algebra inverse function. Okay. This is my A inverse. Eh? This is my A inverse. So if I multiply A inverse, it will be identity matrix, right? Something like that. This is matrix multiplication. Dot. Okay. Okay. And then if I multiply A inverse with a C, this is my C. Yeah, my C. Then I will get my XY, right? Okay, let's run this one by batch mode. Eh? Okay, let's see. Where is it? Oh, inverse method. Okay, I will check my inverse method.py is just that, right? We just shown it. So my Python inverse method.py. Oh yeah, it said, see, if I multiply that, it's almost, this is inverse matrix, actually. This is A, inverse, and then this is multiple identity matrix, and then my xy, x equal 1, y equal minus 2, x equal 1, y equal minus 2. Is it true? Let's check. Yeah, it said x equal 1, minus 2. Yeah. It said x equal 1, y equal minus 2. See, if you put it here, 2 minus 6 minus 4 is fine. 3 plus 2 equal 5. Oh, yeah, it's correct. Yeah, my Python is good. Okay. So, another example is I want to generate the square wave by adding odd harmonics, okay? Yeah, see, this is, okay, so I want to generate the this one. Yeah, this is my square wave, eh? Yeah, this is a t, and this is plus 1, minus 1, t equals 0, t is 1 second. Yeah, the fundamental component of this one is just a sine wave of 1 hertz sine wave, right? Yeah, fundamental component, we know that. Fundamental component is just this one. Ooh. 1 hertz. So this will be something like 5 over 4, something like that. 1 hertz t. Okay. So, you know, this scale wave can be, we can add something like this one, 1/3. And then 1/5. something like that, right? So I can say this one can be written as So sine 2 pi 2n plus 1 hertz t. Yeah, if I make some infinite times, it will be same as that one. Alright, so let's try that one. See, my numpy is imported as MP, my plot byte is here, matplotlib is PLT, I have a time array from 0 to 1 second. This 0 and 1 second is also included. My omega t is 2 pi times t. Okay, if I have only 3, see, I will put my square here. This square is actually sum, the result. So this one is all zeros. The element size is same as that one, right? So this t will generate zero array, okay? Yeah, also this can be generated by another one, mp zeros or something like that. Mp zeros n times, what's n? Oh, this is n. N times what? Type equal float, something like that. MP float 32. It will generate the same thing. 32, okay. Yeah, this T is already a vector of this size, okay? Square is the same as all zeros. Then see my for loop, for I in range n. This range n means see, it starts from 0, 1, 2, 3, and then ends at the n minus 1, okay? Then my square is just added here, starts from 0, right? 1 over 2i plus 1, mp sine omega t times 2i plus 1. Okay, so I just put 3, n equal 3, okay? 3 times, so I plot 4 over pi times this square, my result. Label equal n4. I put PLT show. Where is my PLT show? PLT show is at end. So this time my n equal 10. I repeat the same thing. This time I just sum 10 elements, see, from 1 hertz to 21 hertz, right? 1 hertz, 3 hertz, 5 hertz, all the frequencies, okay? All the harmonics. 1,000 times, say, 1 hertz until 2,000, is it 2,000? Yeah, 2,000, 1 hertz or something like that. 1,000 elements. And then 10,000, oh sorry, 100,000. So, and then I put my plot show. Okay, let's just see what happens. I just already did. So here, blue is 3, n equals 3, and then this one, and 10, and 10 is this one. Green is 1,000, and this red one is 10,000. Okay, let's expand that edge. Let's expand this edge. Yeah, this edge, this is 1,000, this is 100,000. 100,000 close to a square wave, right? Some rounding. Okay. It's not there. All right. Let's go to my place again. Okay. Then, see? In the previous one, I used the repeat the same code, see? I repeat the same code several times, right? So, yeah, here I repeat the same, this one is the same as that one, and also that one, the same code, right? I can use, yeah, they are all the same. This part is all the same, except this part is all the same, right? All the same. except n has different values, then I can use some function definition for the repeated function here. See, yeah, I define the repeated function as a square input elements n and omega t. My omega t is there. I put n there. Square, this part is there. For I in range n, and then I repeat that one, and then return my square. Oops, this is wrong. So this one doesn't work. I have some problem here. Because indentation, we need indentation correct, right? Where is my indentation? Oh yeah, here. See, my function has, is it indentation? Square, 4. Oh yeah, this indentation is wrong. Okay. Oh, how come it doesn't work? Let's see. See, this one, that one. Okay. Oh, how come it doesn't go? See, I have a wrong indentation here. See, this one must go. Oh, how come it doesn't go out? Let me put this away. Okay, let me put that one, delete it. Then let's put it. Oh yeah, now it works. Oh, how come it doesn't go? See, I mean, this one must go. My PowerPoint doesn't work for me. So, let's see. So this square must start after here. Okay. Yeah. Push back. Okay. Let me go to this code in this command window. Okay. I will go to, oops, I will just type that code. What is that code? Oh, square 2. Square 2.python. Let's see. Oh yeah, here see, I put something like that. So this is okay, because my square is there. Alright? So, otherwise, I must, this square must start right part, I mean, around there, okay? If I just put it there. So this is okay. Okay, let's try this one. This will take some time, okay? Python square 2.py. Okay. Yeah, it may take 1 minute or so. Let's do it that way and then go back to our work. Alright. So after some time, we'll see this one. 10,000 million times, right? This million times, very close. Let's go back. Oh yeah, this is 10,000. This is a million times, very close to square, right? Alright. So it doesn't finish yet. Just keep on going, okay? Alright. So, the other step, we have seen for loop here, right? We'll use for loop and if statement. Say for loop is something like that. For I in range n equals 3, 10 or something like that. This is a colon here. Okay, some statement. It must start around here. Some statement 1, statement 2, whatever. There is no end. For the if, say some condition I equal 0, whatever, semicolon, and some statement, L if, not else if, I equal 1, some statement, else, colon, something like that. There is no end. Eh? Those else and we have some statement there, right? Those are colon. We need a colon for Python. Python, this indentation is very critical. it must be exactly located at the exact position. All right, so this is the introduction to Python. Let's go back to the main job. Say, we want to model this charge pump PLL using Python code. All right. This charge pump PLL, see this input is RepCLK, it's array, I mean vector. So this is VCO divided clock, another array, vector. And then, see, this it consists of phase frequency detector, charge pump, this part is a loop filter, this is a charge pump circuit, and low dropout regulator amplifies the current driving capability. It's not included in this behavior model. So this VC is the same as this one, loop filter output. And this VCO is a voltage controlled oscillator. This one is a VCO CLK, another array. This N divider is 16. So we'll use a rep clock 40 MHz here. 40 MHz clock signal. Then it will generate 640 MHz VCO CLK, another clock. Okay. So phase locked loop is a negative feedback circuit on phase. PFD detects the phase difference between RepCLK and VCO divided clock. This should be 40 MHz, right? Say, if the loop gain, you know, this is a feedback circuit and the negative feedback circuit, if the loop gain is large enough, the phase difference should be zero. Okay, phase error between RepCLK and VCO CLK must be zero. It means the frequency should be the same, right? So it means they are aligned. So if my RepCLK is like that, this is my RepCLK, and then my VCO CLK should be aligned. Okay, where is it? Yeah, aligned means something like that. Same frequency, phase are the same. This is my VCO divided CLK, okay? That's a PLL. All right. So this charge pump PLL, almost all digital implementation. See, for the analog circuit, loop filter, low dropout regulator, they are analog. Yeah, this part is analog. Otherwise, this phase frequency detector accepts phase difference generate a digital signal. This is 1 or 0. Yeah, this is VDD. VDD equals 3 volt in this example. And then this is 3 volt or 0 volt up down. They are digital. And then current source. Yeah, current source is actually analog. This is analog. Yeah, this ring oscillator, voltage control oscillator, digital, frequency divider, digital. So, because of digital implementation, the circuit size can be small. So, we have an integration operation here, loop filter, current source, and then this loop filter. Loop filter is basically capacitor. This R1 is added to enhance stability by adding zero. Negative real zero. So this is a capacitor and this charge pump current source performs integration operation. But usually integrator requires an amplifier, something like that. My conventional integrator is something like that. So RC, this is active RC integrator. We need an amplifier for the conventional integration, but here current source and just a simple capacitor performs integration. There is no amp required. Okay, yeah, this integrator makes infinite DC gain for this loop. Loop gain is infinite at DC, It means DC offset is zero. DC offset is offset phase. DC offset phase is zero. Because loop gain is infinite at DC. Okay. So this PFT is, it will generate if my, this is by I for the rep CLK. 40 MHz clock, this is by int. See, this is VCO divide CLK. Okay. Yeah, this PFT will generate, see, if my input phase is leading this output phase, my up equal 1, which is 3 volt, my down equal 0. Okay. Otherwise, yeah, my up equal 0 and my down equal 1. Yeah, this digital. So PFD is a kind of a 1-bit analog digital converter. So it depending on the polarity, it's kind of comparator, base comparator. So PFD converts analog base difference into digital signal. Okay. So let's decide loop build parameters R1, C1, C2 from given values. So given values are charge pump current 100 microamp, and then VCO gain is 626 megahertz per volt. Usually we need 2pi radian, right? Divider ratio 16, input frequency 40 megahertz. Then my PLL bandwidth is set to 2 MHz, okay, which is 120. So this is around that way, input frequency. PLL bandwidth is depends on input frequency, which is 40 MHz here. Phase margin 60 degrees. Those are given parameters. So here, see, we need stability analysis. This is a loop gain. H open is my loop gain of this feedback loop. Okay, my loop gain is see, it starts from PFD and then goes back and then comes back here. Okay, this is my loop gain. Okay, so yeah, see, this is a K VCO. See, I assume LDO is gain 1. This is this is PFD, and then this charge pump, the gain is ICP of 2pi. This is up, down. If up, down is 1 or 0, and this is ICP 2pi times those base difference by I by int. My by int is here. Okay. So those are some average, average value. So so my loop gain is this phase detector and charge pump gain. And then this is loop filter impedance, and then this is a VCO gain, and then which means this frequency, this output frequency is linearly proportional to this control voltage, right? And then besides, and then see, this is a phase, right? Because my PFT identifies this phase difference, converts this phase difference into up-down signal. So it should be phase. So this is frequency, K VCO frequency. To convert this frequency into phase, I have 1 of S there, right? And then if multiply 1 of N, so this completes my loop gain, okay? So see, for the stability, for the phase margin, and then unity gain bandwidth. Okay, this is my loop gain, magnitude of my loop gain. And then see, if you look at the frequency dependence, say this one is here, and then from here, see this is 1 of omega. So this is my pole frequency here, right? Zero frequency. So this unity gain frequency, which is PLL bandwidth, okay? PLL bandwidth is the frequency where loop gain becomes 0 decibel, which is 1, okay? So yeah, here at the omega bandwidth. So this at this frequency, see, if you look at the phase characteristic here, so at this omega bandwidth, which is the same as this PLL bandwidth, which is 2 MHz in this example. Here, see, the phase should be, yeah, this will generate 180 degrees. This phase margin must be 60 degrees here. Okay, phase margin is this phase and then difference of this phase from this minus 180 degrees, right? So from this condition, we'll decide the R1 and the C1, okay? So yeah, let's find this equation, PLL bandwidth. Yeah, from the spec, this is 2 MHz, right? It's a given. Then, see, if you find the magnitude equation here, so this, if I substitute omega equal omega BW, this magnitude should be 1, right? So if I substitute all those things, it must be 1. Then, see, let's see, okay. Yeah, that's magnitude. How about this phase? This phase, minus 180 degrees. Minus 180 degrees for this part, and this part, arctangent plus arctangent omega BW. This is omega BW. And then this is the phase of this one, right? This part. And then difference between this phase and that phase is my phase margin, right? So I subtract minus 180, which is this is deleted out. So this part should be 60 degrees, right? So I have two equations, this equation and that equation. Right? If I substitute this one here, I have another equation. So let's see. We have a given bandwidth. Yeah, this is 2 MHz, which is 1/20 of input frequency and phase margin. So from phase margin equation, I have R1, C1, this is given. So I have a condition for product of R1, C1. And then from magnitude equation, we can find either R1 or C1, right? And then by using the, because we have unknown R1 and C1, those two unknowns. And then we have two equations, right? One is phase margin equation, one is magnitude equation. So we can determine two parameters. C2 just comes 10% of C1 to smoothing out. So in this example, see my R1 is around 2.8K, my C1 is around 50 picofarad, my C2 is 5 picofarad, okay? So this R1 C1 product is around 1.15 MHz, right? So let's see. My transfer function is defined by output phase divided by input phase. So, see, this is my forward gain. This H1S is that one, okay? This is my H1S. Forward gain, 1 plus loop gain. My loop gain is there, right? This is my loop gain, my forward gain. So if you look at this one, this is my board gain, right? Oh, the board gain is here. In my board gain, there is no 1 of n, right? So it's, then we can just set my board gain is loop gain. This is my loop gain. Loop gain times n. This is my board gain, right? So then we can find this equation. or a Lopez filter, right? Lopez filter. Say, for this one, my omega zero is, this omega zero is around 1.4 megahertz. My quality factor is 0.8, very stable, right? So the magnitude response of this one, see, at the low frequency, gain is 1, right? So it's something like that. At the PLL bandwidth, which is 2 megahertz, right? It's something like that, right? And then will be reduced. So that's my magnitude of the plot of this transfer function. Output phase, which is V0CLK 640 MHz, and this sine is phase of RAPCLK, okay? Yeah. So that's a brief operation, brief summary of PLL operation. Let's move to building block of charge pump PLL by using Python language. Okay, so let's go over the variable names. RAPCLK, which is a 40 MHz clock, which will be array for the entire time. This is VCO divided clock, another array. And then this is VCO CLK. Yeah, this is a 640 MHz one. And then this is my VC. And this is same as my VC. That's loop filter. There is another one, C2. C2 will be not included in the behavior model. Oh, actually, they are included in the loop filter. In the transfer function, it's not included. But in the behavior model, it is included. Okay? So yeah, up down signal is the same. Let's go one by one. Okay, so I will use the function definition of a charge pump PLL. Input is a RAPCLK, which is a 40 MHz clock. And then this is N is a number of time points for analysis, all time points. And then T step is numerical time step for numerical analysis. We'll just proceed by one T step to another. It means it starts at T equals 0, and then next one is T equal T step, and then the next one is T equal 2 T step or something like that. We'll proceed in this one. T step is 1 picosecond. This is supply voltage, which is 3 volt here. Okay. So, yeah, those are comment. So we'll set some parameters. We allocate some memory for those signals. Initialization of parameters. So we'll go over for loop for each time step. Range n means it starts from 0, 1, 2. My I changes 0 for the first time, and then it will change to 1 until n minus 1. Okay? So, and then each building block is declared. Phase frequency detector, charge pump circuit, filter circuit, VCO circuit, frequency divider circuit, and then it iterates, right? And then finally, it returns a loop filter control voltage, PLL output voltage, which has a 50 phase. This is a by int. It returns three variables. They are all declared as vectors. So, yeah, let's go over a real code. Say we'll import NumPy as NP. And then matplotlib.pyplot as a PLT. So this is a definition of my charge pump PLL. So my function ends by colon, okay? And then RAPCLK, which is by I, and then number of time points, and it's input, time step, VDD, those are input. Yeah, so my PLL bandwidth, and from those parameters, we found R1, charge pump current C1 around 50 picofarad C2 divider and K ratio, which is hertz per volt. So those are parameters. So those are some parameters for loop filter. Okay, we'll go there at the loop filter. So some array allocation. NumPy zeros, a number of elements, D type, float 32, up, down. So, and then this loop filter control voltage, and then some state variables for the loop filter. This VCO CLK phase filter output, this is a bi-int, this is a bio. Yeah, for the essential ones are those things. See, they are return variables, okay? They are all return variables. Yeah, some up, down, and those variables can be, we may not need those array allocation if we change code. But if we have array allocation, we can monitor very easily. Some initialization parameters are there. For the VCO is 1.5 volt initially, and then the clock frequency is 450 megahertz. At the 450 megahertz is a VCO output frequency at the VC equal 1.5 volt. Okay, that's a VCO initial condition. So let's start with the phase frequency detector. So this is a REPCLK, and this is a VCO divided clock. Okay, sorry. So sometimes we call pi int. Sometimes this one is pi I, and then we have up down signal. So this is a positive edge triggered flip flop. Both of them, positive edge triggered flip flop. See, it means, at the rising edge of this REPCLK, this Q up goes to 1, okay? Up goes to 1, high level. And then at the rising edge of this INTCLK, which is output clock, my down goes to 1. If both 1, both up and down are 1, 1, 1, 0, and 0, and then they are reset to 0, okay? By this reset operation of flip-flop. So they are go back to 0. If both 1, they go to reset to 0 and 0, okay? So that's a PFD operation. So here, see, this is a 4i range, and so this I is, see, my t equal I times t step, okay? So yeah, this is only heartbeat. So PFT generates up-down signal. Yeah, there are some delay. Delay is number of time steps. Okay, if for the initial I equal 0 and I equal 1, they are all 0. And then if there is otherwise, VCO clock has rising edge here. This is a rising transition. Oh no, this is VCO divided clock, output clock. Down equal 1, otherwise down stays at the previous time point value. If this is int, I used the I minus 1, I minus 2, because REPCLK I is not decided yet. It will be decided this is decided, this one is not decided. This one is decided in the after part, in the backward part of this for loop. So that's why I use the I minus 1, I minus 2, instead of I minus 1 and I. Okay, those are PFD reset delay. So this one will determine some dead zone. But now it's 0. So next one is a charge pump circuit. Yeah, this is a charge pump circuit. Sorry, this is a charge pump circuit, not loop filter yet. Charge pump. This part is a loop filter. Charge pump circuit generates those switches, up down switches. This is up bar. Say if up is high, or when up is high, let's see. This up bar is low, and the current flows like that. This is up. See, if up equals 1, down equals 0. Because down equals 0, this is 1, down bar. So the current of this one is flows like that. So then, see, some charge, delta Q. Delta Q will be supplied to this loop filter. So this Q1, Q2, and then there is minus Q1, minus Q2 there. Yeah, the capacitor charge is sum of Q1 plus Q2. So my QC will be increased by delta Q in. This delta Q in is a charge pump current times T step, okay? So my delta QC will be same as delta Q in. Yeah, if the situation is reversed, then there is a negative charge here. Okay, if up equal 0, down equal 1, say, there is a current path like that. So here's my delta Q in will be minus ICP times T step. Okay. So my delta QC, which is the sum of those two, will be reduced in this red case. This amplifier is added to keep this one. See, to keep charge sharing, say, so it keeps this voltage and that voltage almost the same as this VC voltage, almost the same. Then there is no charge sharing between those capacitors and this parasitic capacitance. Those are some parasitic capacitance here, right? If this parasitic capacitance is charged to VDD or discharged to VSS, and then it will go it just consumes some charge. There is my VC will be inaccurate. This amplifier prevents charge sharing by those two parasitic capacitance. Okay. So my charge pump is up equal 1, down equal 0, and my delta Q will be plus. Otherwise, see, you can see some column there. My delta Q is negative. Otherwise, 0. My delta Q is 0. Okay? Let's go to the loop filter model. Loop filter is, there are the main idea is borrowed from this book. My loop filter is a continuous time system. We need a discrete time system here, right? So here, I have my delta Q in there. We want to determine control voltage of this loop filter output because my VC determines VC output frequency. Okay, so my transfer function must be this VC divided by delta Q in. Delta Q in is a charge pump output, right? Delta Q in is injected charge during T step. So my delta Q, this is if up is 1 or 0, 0 or 1. So my delta Q in is ICP times T step times up minus down. So then if I have my charge here, so I have two capacitors. My loop filter charge is sum of those two charges, Q1 plus Q2. If I have delta Q in injected, it will increase my QC, right? Because of delta Q in will be directly added to QC. So my delta Q in is same as my delta QC. which is the difference between those two. Okay, so we can say this is n minus 1 or something like that. Okay, then see my delta q in is you can, if I convert this one in discrete time domain, something like that. So qc, my qct is converted into qcg in the g domain, okay, for discrete time analysis. So this delay operator is g minus 1 there. All right, so my charge pump output is represented by qc here, qc expression, which is charge of this loop filter. Okay, so then see, let's go back my transfer function. So here see my transfer function is converted like that. This then this QC divided by this VC divided by this QC. QC is actually, if I have some current component here, okay, this is my current from charge pump circuit. This is just integration of this current, right? So see, I can say in a continuous time domain, this is still my S domain. My QC is just integration of this current, okay? Charge pump current, right? So because this is in the denominator, my S goes to the numerator side, and then this is nothing but the impedance of loop filter, right? V divided by VC divided by current is should be my impedance, okay? So for this, we just define this VC divided by QC as MS. So let's this impedance of this loop filter can be easily described by a parallel connection of C2 impedance and this series connection of R1 C1, right? So we can write my impedance like that. We have S square S term there, so I should multiply this one by S, and then this is gone, something like that. So my MS can be written like that. My MS is ratio of loop filter output voltage and loop filter charge. QC is a sum of Q1, Q2, right? QC is a sum of Q1 plus Q2. Okay. QC equal Q1 plus Q2. Okay. All right. So, yeah, we want to convert this MS into a discrete time domain by using a bilinear transform, which is derived from trapezoid integration, right? Trapezoid integration is if some waveform is like that, and n plus 1, and then this is a t over t step, and then trapezoid integration is just a linear straight line, and then this area corresponds to integration. Then my mg, discrete time domain ms, is converted like that. Say, we can derive those coefficients m1, m2, and then k here. Okay, this there is a common vector denominator d here. All right, so then our final transfer function, loop filter output voltage with respect to charge pump output charge from charge pump circuit. So it can be derived by this one times mg, right? This is my mg, okay? So my mg is here, and then there is mg times c, my pz, which is loop filter output voltage vc divided by charge pump output, which is charge pump input to the loop filter, is a derivative times this one, m1, m2. So to model this one, we convert this one into this PZ into a signal flow graph. So this part is here. There is X1 here. This X1 is actually QC, which is a sum of C1 capacitor and C2 capacitor. Okay. So this delta Q in, delta Q in is a charge pump output. So then this part is modeled. This part is modeled like that. See, you can see my loop gain is here. See, in this case, my loop gain is 1 minus k g minus 1, right? So if I have so my denominator like that, because 1 minus loop gain and forward gain, okay? So my forward gain is, see, this is M1. Yeah, that's my forward gain, M1 plus, there is M2. M2 is multiplied here, not there. So my M2 is applied at this branch, okay? M2G minus 1. So this completes my signal flow graph. Then I have two state variables here. See, because I have two energy storage elements, I have two state variables, which is X1 and X2 there. X2 is at this point, okay? X2 has no physical counterpart. It's a combination of some state variables. All right. Then, see, we can model like that. See, my X1, which is QC, equal delta Q in times, this is input, charge pump output, right? And then X1 M plus 1. See, my X1 is, you can see, this pass and that pass. You know, the lower pass has this one, right? Because of delaying element, it's a X1 M minus 1, the previous time step value. And then next one is my X2, this is a state variable. My X2 comes, see, M2 is there, right? X2 comes, X1. X2 comes from this path, and another path is this one, right? So I have two paths. One is X1, right? This is the one, this one. And then there is another one, which is 1 minus k times delayed version of X2, right? That's it. How about this control voltage? Control voltage is, let's change color. My control voltage has two paths. M1 times X2, which is M1 times X2 there. And then M2 times delayed version of X2, right? M2 times the delayed burden of X2. So we will implement those three equations by using Python code. Okay. Okay. One thing to solve is the initial condition. See, if you look at the those ones, say we need the initial condition. What I mean is my loop filter voltage is given. Okay. See, this is a loop filter voltage at the t equals 0. Loop filter voltage at the time 0. T equals 0. Then from this, we need to compute x1 and x2. You can see those equations in the previous slide. So at the DC, they are the same. Okay, they are the same. This is just x2 0. Because this is a DC. Then see, this is a zero, VC zero, initial condition. Then we can derive this equation, right? My X2 zero is derived from second equation. Similarly, this X1 zero is, this is the same as X2 zero, DC. This is X2 zero, right? From this equation, see, we can find out my X20 is deleted out like that. Then I have my initial condition like that. So we can decide the initial values of state variables X1 and X2. Okay, so my loop filter, those are some parameters. This is a common parameter. It's outside of for loop, okay? For the initial condition, this is a VC initial loop filter initial condition, right? So we use the initial condition equation. Otherwise, we use the those are initial condition equation. We use the those equations here, right? You can see delta Q in is delta Q from the charge pump output. We can see exact correspondence here. that's it for the loop filter. Oh, oh, sorry, it's wrong place. Oh, 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 oh. Okay. Yeah, next one is V-show. V-show output frequencies can be K-V-show, which is Hertz per volt times VCN. This is N minus VC initial. VC initial is actually 1/2, 1.5 volt. Times at the initial frequency is 450 megahertz. Okay, so this is my V-show output frequency, which is linearly proportional to loop filter output voltage. Okay, so here see my K-show is here, so it's set outside of ball loop. Okay. So those are initial condition, I equals 0 at t equals 0, and then see we know the V-show, this is initial frequency 450 megahertz here, okay? Then I calculate the half period. So this is half t, right? Half t. And then it's divided by n step is number of time steps for the half period. So transition point is I plus half period. If this point reached, I will switch this V-show CLK value. So we need the average of those loop filter output voltages during the time. So else if I doesn't reach yet transition point, I just average this loop filter output voltage, right? This loop filter output voltage divided by half period count. And then, see, this will be my average loop filter voltage. My V-show output will remain the same. Yeah, if this point is reached, my V-show output flips state. 0 to VDD, VDD to 0. It flips the state, right? And then I calculate the frequency again. And then I calculate the half period counter again. And then I set new half period time point. And then reset my VC average value. Okay, that's it for the VCO. And then frequency divider, there is a simple frequency divider by using four flip-flops, positive edge triggered. So if I apply 640 MHz here, which is V-show CLK array, and then after some this frequency, this will be 40 MHz, which is V-show divide clock CLK. Okay. Yeah, that's a frequency divider. See here, see initial condition is all zero, and then at the rising edge of V-show output, we just increase the count by one, and then divide clock remains the same, and then if the counter else, oh yeah, this may not necessary, right? May not necessary, repeated. So say this is, there is end, there is no else, right? End. And then there is, you can see all those indentation. It should be exactly same position, okay? Say if count reaches eight, I flip the divided clock and then set to zero, otherwise keep the value. So this may not be necessary. And then that's the end of frequency divider. And then this is the end of charge pump PLL. Returns loop filter output voltage, PLL output, which is by zero. And this is a divided clock, which is by int. Okay? It returns three arrays. So now, we want to use this PLL for phase demodulation. So here, see, this is a loop filter output. And then if I modulate, there is a phase modulation at the input. Then that phase demodulated value will be shown here. Phase demodulated at the VC. Demodulated. Okay, so I need a transfer function, this VC of this phi I. VC of phi I. This phi I is my input phase. So here is the transfer function. See VC of phi I. Oh. This VC, loop filter output voltage, this phase input phi I. So this H2 is my transfer function, which is loop filter output divided by input phase. Okay. The initial transfer function was this value, phi O or phi I. Okay, the position is different. You know, this is a KV show there, actually 2 pi KV show, 2 pi KV show, and there is one of S there, right? So, because of this VC, my loop gain is quite different. So, forward gain. My forward gain is this PFD gain times loop filter. Okay, that's my forward gain. 1 minus loop gain is here. It's the same. So if I divide my loop gain equation there, see I have a high pass filter here. Okay, this S. So it is a high pass filter. You know, this was a low pass filter, right? This was a high pass filter for the phase demodulation. You know, those omega 0 and Q are represented by R1, C1, and others, okay? So let's see. Oh, it's not given here. Should be there. Let's see. Let's go back. It's not derived. We can find that one. Let's see. Omega 0. Yeah, that part is not shown here. Oh yeah, actually it was shown in the previous case, right? For this H1 case, we can find the omega 0 and the Q equation in this H1S derivation in the preceding slide. Okay, so if there is a phase step, let's see, what's this phase step look like? Okay, phase step. There is a phase step in the middle. Zero phase step. Say, in this example, at the t equal 2 microseconds, say we simulate the 0 to 4 microseconds. At the middle, we have a phase step of like that. Say we have a clock signal, right? Clock signal. 400 megahertz. Eh? 40 megahertz clock signal. This is RepCLK. And then here, at the t equal 2 microseconds, if there is a phase shift like that, what does it look like? It leads, right? Say this is 5 radian. So it leads something like that. Let's see. It leads something like that. Let's see. Let me see. Is it right? Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. This one is RepCLK, and this is RepCLK omega t or whatever. This is RepCLK. Omega t plus those 0.95 pi radian or something like that. Okay, This next one leads the first one, the upper one, by 0.95. So it means, Repshield K follows this one first, and then here, until this point, right? And then from T equal 2 microsecond, because of phase state, it will follow like that. The next one, right? So in if I add them together, it should look like that. Okay. It should look like that. So my Repshield K is something like that. So at the T equal 2 microsecond, there is some sort of glitch here. And then 2 pi radian, the frequency are the same. But here, is it true or not? Oh yeah, sure. This is a shorter. Is it right? Shorter. No, that's not shorter. The first one is at the 2 microsecond, right? Oh, sorry. This point is 2 microsecond, okay? So that's not that point, this point. So this is 1 half T, okay? Is it right? Nope. This is not 2 point. This is half a point. The first one is shorter, okay? Yeah, the first one. Is it the first one? Is the same as this one? Nope. It follows another one. Shorter. Yeah. Okay. Anyway, there is some sort of glitch there. It's accommodated. Say, I think this should be 1/2 or something like that. So there is a phase step of 0.95 pi phase step. So let's calculate the by using this transfer function. We want to calculate the VCS first. So what's my VCS? VCS will be H2S. This is only 0.95 pi of S, right? Pi of S. We multiply H2S and this input, and then we just, this is gone, right? We can get this equation. And then we just convert that one like that. And then you can see there is some exponential decay, and then this is a cosine, sine, something like that. All right, so we can derive this one like that. There is exponential term, and then this omega n term. Omega n equal 2 pi something 1.1 megahertz, something like that, okay? And this is actually time constant is 2q. 2q of omega 0 equal 2q square of r1 c1, something like that, okay? This is around 180 nanosecond here. That's time constant, exponential minus t of time constant, right? This is my time constant. Okay, there is some exponential decay with a time constant of 180 nanosecond, and then ringing frequency of 1.1 megahertz, and cosine and sine, okay? At the t equals 0, this thing is 0, this is 1, and then we have some step here, right? So my VCT look like a phase step. Oh, is it? Oh, this is a phase ramp. My VCT will look like 0, and at the t equals 0, something like that, okay? So this will be my VCT. This step is this value, okay? That's a step here. All right. Okay, next one is phase ramp. See, the Repshield K is clock frequency of 40 MHz until t equal 2 microsecond. After that, it changes to 45 megahertz. Okay? So it's easy. See, 440 megahertz there. And then it increases frequency to 45 megahertz at 2 microsecond, right? So then this lamp is one of S square, right? One of S square 2 pi this 45 megahertz, yeah. 5 megahertz. 40 to 45 megahertz T. So this is my input. And if I multiply there, see my VCS can be derived like that, and then it's a time domain, it's a 1 minus exponential thing and cosine omega in TUT, right? So if I multiply 0 here, T equals 0, this is a 0, this is a 1, this is a 1, and then what? This is starts from 0, right? My VCT is a 0, and then oscillate to some value, right? If this decays out, it just go to that one. So this is my new value, P. Final value. This is my final value, right? My final value. 5 megahertz divided by VCO. Okay. So next one is just a phase modulation at the steady state. We just modulate the phase of RepCLK. Okay, RepCLK, its phase look like 2 pi, 40 megahertz times T. And then we added some phase modulation component there, right? This phase modulation component is this is phi in. Phase modulation pi radian. So it just sweeps between plus minus pi radian at the frequency of 1 megahertz. So you know, PLL bandwidth is 2 megahertz, right? 2 pi, 2 megahertz. So 1 megahertz is okay. So we can reproduce this phase modulation at the low filter output voltage at the VC. Okay, so this case is, steady state. I mean, there is no UT here. Then we just substitute the S equal 2 pi, 1 megahertz here, J 2 pi, 1 megahertz. Then multiply exponential thing and then take imaginary because this is a sine. Then we can find my VCT here. Oops, where is my VCT? Oh yeah, actually we can calculate that. Say there is some phase shift and then magnitude change. All right, so let's go back to the Python code. Say there are some general parameters, rep, CLK, frequency, 40 MHz. My definition of charge pump PLL must be declared before calling. So this comes after function declaration. And then my N is T final, T step. My T final is 4 microsecond. Okay, my time array is linear space between 0 and T final minus T step N. So they are included, both included, right? So number point is 1. So there are some parameters, charge pump current, loop filter parameters, divide ratio, KVCO. This is omega 0 for calculation, hand analysis, okay? So that's mp square root something. This is omega n. Is it omega n? No, omega 0. Omega 0 is around 1.4 megahertz, okay? Times 2 pi. Quality factor, yeah, which is around 0.8 in this example. And Q factor. Q factor. Oh, just another one. Omega n is around 1. This times omega n is around 1.1 megahertz, and this time constant is around 180 nanoseconds in this example. Okay, so here see my rep frequency is this sine function. Sine function is just sine x equal plus 1 if x positive, minus 1 if x negative, otherwise x equals 0. Something like that. Okay, that's a sine function. So it converts this sine wave into a clock signal. So this is 2 pi 40 megahertz. This is 2 pi 40 megahertz, right? So it's if I add plus 1, it's 0 and 1, right? 0 and 2. So if I multiply 1.5, it swings between 0 and 3 volt, okay? Phase is just arrayed or the same size as T. And then constant phase, just a DC shift, okay, here. Say 640 megahertz minus 450 megahertz divided by K ratio. That's VC plus initial voltage. So that's my DC loop filter output, okay? At 640 megahertz output. That's a constant phase. My buy-in equals zero in this case because the phase doesn't change. And then next one is phase step. Yeah, you can phase step of 0.95 radian. So we'll see this RevCLK changes. RevCLK changes a phase at the t equal 2 microsecond. Okay, just something like that. Say, oh, sorry, shouldn't be like that. Frequency are the same, just a phase shift. So here is this T equal 1 over 40 megahertz, which is 25 nanosecond, right? So here is this one is half T, 1 over 2T, 1 over 2T. There is some additional 0.05 radian divided by 2T, 2 pi times T, right? That's the time. And then this is half T. Yeah, they have, oh, sorry. Oh, yeah, this is half T actually. This is half T. Yeah, half T. There's a half T. All half T, but there is some phase shift additional glitch-like pattern there, okay? That's a phase step of phase step of 0.95 pi radian UT. This UT is actually 2 microsecond, okay? Something like that. Okay, so yeah, then see, I have a half size array A here. My half size array, this half time is 2 microsecond, okay? Entire time is, oh, say, this is wrong, this should be 2.5, okay? Phase step. Oh, sorry, 2 microsecond. Then, see, this is no phase shift, 2 pi 40 megahertz there, until for the first half. And the next half is, it has phase shift here, phase step there, right? Is it T half? Yeah, T half. T1 plus T half, okay? T1 plus T half. T half is 2 microsecond. Alright, then I just concatenate this one, A and B. Two arrays are concatenated, make a long array, RevCLK1, okay? A and B are each 2 microsecond one. This is a 4 microsecond array, okay? By concatenation. And then for the phase, see, I put zero allocation there of half size. And then I added B, that one. I just concatenate that one. So my phase one looks like a zero, and then 0.95 pi. After t equal 2 microsecond, okay? That's my phase one array for comparison input. And then see, there are some calculation. See this. For the trans function approach, we used added this one. A is just zero, B is another half. We just calculated that. This is size. We want to set the same size, same half size right there. Okay. So those are equations from transfer function analysis. If I concatenate those, this is a VC1 calc. Okay. VC calc will be derived by calling the function definition of charge pump PLL. Okay. We'll compare. Okay. So is it there? Not yet. Not yet. Not called yet. Right? So this is input preparation. My input is RepCLK1, and I calculated the predicted output, VC1 calc for the loop built output voltage. Okay. So there, see, for the phase ramp, same thing happens, right? Same thing. My input has just this one, added this one. Okay. This T1 is a half size, 2 microsecond array. We made T1 there, right? Oh yeah, here. This is a half size array, okay? From zero to half, okay, half time. So, yeah. And then see, there is a phase ramp there. So for the B, we added those phase ramp equation here, okay? This is 40 megahertz divided by 8, which is 5 megahertz, right? So I have a phase 2. This is phase change. So I have calculated the prediction. Okay, so this is just a phase modulation. My phase modulation index, this phase 3 is just a steady state. It just extends the whole time span of 2 microseconds, okay? Phase modulation index is pi times 1 megahertz, okay, 1 megahertz modulation, plus minus pi. And then my RepCLK3 is just added, but this is continuation. There shouldn't be any character after this backslash for the continuation. So here, see, this one, 2 pi, 40 megahertz plus this phase modulation part, okay? Phase modulation part is there. So those are prediction from transfer function calculation. So this one is now the calling. This must be placed after declaration in Python. So this is no phase input, no phase change, and number of time points, T-step VDD, and then output is VC0. This is a loop built output voltage, right? Without phase, this is PLL output 640 megahertz one. This is 5 int 40 megahertz output. Okay. For the RepCLK1 phase step, so this is VC1 phase ramp. RepCLK2, this is VC2. This is sine phase modulation VC3. Okay. So here, see, we want to plot. Say for the first one. Figure 1, this is phase input. Phase input, all those phase inputs are compared. Eh? This is not necessary because it defaults from 0 to final, which is 4 microseconds. So I have some title, and then this is the end of figure 1. Next one is VC0. All VCs are shown in a single graph for figure 2. So third one is VC0 and VC0 calc for the no phase input, okay, in figure 3, PLT show. Okay, next one is phase step, VC1 from this matlab code simulation, and then this is from calculation based on transfer function. This is for the phase step, and then this is a phase ramp from a Python code, and then this is a control calculation from transfer function, VC3 from Python code, and then this is from calculation from transfer function for the sine modulated, steady state modulation. Okay, so this is a phase input. See, this is 4 microsecond here, and then 2 microsecond, some changes there. So those are phase. Yeah, for the blue one is no phase shift, and then this red one is a phase shift of 0.95 radian u t minus 2 microsecond, right? And then see, this is a phase ramp, which is 2 pi 5 megahertz t minus 2 microsecond times u t minus 2 microsecond, okay? That's a phase ramp. And then this is my PSEP, right? PSEP. And this is my PSEP. And what's this my PSEP? PSEP is just a pi radian times what? Steady state, right? Sine 2 pi 1 megahertz. 1 megahertz t. Okay, that's a steady state one. There is no ut for the steady state sine modulation. Okay? Yeah, then see those are looped output voltages. Yeah, you can compare. See, this green one is actually zero phase. Yeah, see from zero, it takes around 0.7 microsecond for the settle, right? For the settling. See, blue one is no phase shift, and then see this one is sine modulation, steady state sine modulation, and then green one is what? Green one is phase ramp. The green one is phase ramp, and then yellow thing is phase step. Page step. So T step equal 1 picosecond. So there is no phase change here. See, it takes around 0.7 microsecond for settle to be settled. This starts from 1.5 volt and then goes to around 1.8 volt, right? And then stays here with some glitches. Okay, then next one is phase step. See, I have a phase step here. Red one is a calculation, and then blue one is from Python. So similar, right? Except some ripples. Ripples of around 20 millivolt. Is it 20 millivolt? Yeah, so this is 50 millivolt, right? Yeah, it's larger than 20. Yeah, here around, say, 30 millivolt or something like that. There are some ripples. So this is a phase ramp. Say, changes to 45 megahertz here, from 40 megahertz there. You can see similar close match, right? Except the ripple. And then this is a steady state sine phase modulation, right? So it's not really doesn't look like a sine. But here, until here, see, it's not settled yet. But after settling, it's close, right? This is a VC from Python. Red one is from transfer function, okay?